the first step is me figuring out this mic.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Good. Like really loud? Is it too loud? Oh, feedbacky. Well, shit. I don't know what I don't know what to do about that. Rory, help. Just a second.
Also loud. Loud.
Yeah, I actually used to be in a heavy metal band when I was in college. Some habits never go away. Ooh, maybe I'll turn that off for a second.
Pardon us while we deal with these technical difficulties. Wow, that's really weird to like, you know, be yelling at you guys from up here. And, hello, my fellow nerds.
Yeah!
Thanks so much to Rory for having us out tonight. Thanks to my co-presenters, Jen and Chase. We're hoping to give you guys some information about natural history, aspects of natural history. But most of all, we're just here to drink a beer and have a good time. Hopefully you guys will too. So maybe I'll get started. Are we good to go?
Hello? Is that a little better?
Yes.
All right, you know what? I'm gonna yell. Try again.
Hello? Hello?
Hi. That's
Hello?
Okay.
It's like it the longer it goes, the more it more it feeds back.
It's okay. Right.
Okay, I know, but I have to reach the computer to change the slides. So I mean that works at one level, but if I
don't use the mic and yell at you guys, can you hear me?
No. Do you want to use the handheld?
Yes. You can hand out.
Hello.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you for bearing with me there. As I tell you about stupid shit in Jurassic Park. So I wanted to start off by saying that, like, you know, this talk is going to be, you know, pretty negative to some aspects of Jurassic Park. But I also wanted to confess that I am, like many people of my Generation X, somebody who really enjoyed the first Jurassic Park movie when it came out. And in fact, I was the... Oh, are you going to advance my slides for it? Oh my God, all right.
Thank you.
Oh, that was intentional. Like I planned that the whole time. Actually, Lauren, if you want to stay there and advance slides, I don't know. Okay. All right. Yeah. This is Lauren. Everybody, Lauren, give it up for Lauren. All right, and I can now hold my beer in peace. So I was one of those, and Lauren, you can go to the next slide. This is my attempt at illustrating a magical moment from Jurassic Park. I was in high school when this came out, and I'll confess that I'm a paleontologist now. My job is to study dinosaurs. I'm at the Carnegie Museum of Natural History. Who's been there?
Yeah!
I'm getting to live my dream. When I was a little kid, I wanted to be either an NFL football player or a dinosaur paleontologist, and look at how I grew up. So you know which one I got. But Jurassic Park was incredibly influential to me. So before I take this down, I wanted to just share a magical moment from the movie that maybe is magical to some of you as well. Yep, a quick play song. This is like such an incredible moment, like to the point where I still get chills when I see this. This is what I was imagining my whole life as a little kid.
The species of Veriformin's been extinct since the Cretaceous period. I mean, this thing isn't on this thing.
Thank you.
this. You crazy son of a bitch, you did. It was terrible. The little book on it. God, that is, it doesn't apply. That's totally wrong. This is a warm-blooded creature.
This thing doesn't live in the swamp.
This thing's got, what, a 25, 27 foot neck? Like, it's all 30.
So imagine yourself as 17-year-old me. You'd been thinking about dinosaurs. I know it's a painful thought. I'd been thinking about dinosaurs, imagining that scene my whole damn life. And then this comes on the screen. I was completely blown away. And today, you know, I get paid to study dinosaurs. I'm living the dream I had when I was a little kid. So this was incredibly influential for me. That being said, like this image here of Chris Pratt taking a selfie with this scary-ass dinosaur, there's not every moment in Jurassic Park is a great one, and there are some things that are scientifically maybe slightly dubious. I'm glad I'm being funnier than I thought I was, so that's good. And what this talk is going to be is effectively a little bit of a highlight reel of some of those things, or a low light reel, so to speak. So to get started, I wanted to make sure that Lauren, can you advance the slide, please? And I have to remember one other thing to tell Lauren to advance slides for me. Thank you again. But I wanted to, it got cut off at the top. It looks like the slide headings are cut off at the top, but this is an actual piece of fossilized Tyrannosaurus Rex shit. And the scientific name for these are coprolites. And this is the only known likely Tyrannosaurus Rex coprolite. And so we're gonna use this giant fossilized piece of shit to assess some of the some of the less scientifically sound things in Jurassic Park. Next slide, please, Lauren. Thank you. So we'll give this a second. But basically, what the top says is Matt's shittiness scale. Trademarked, like, you know, not really. But the top, you know, so one T-Rex coprolite means this is forgivable. Scientific evidence was equivocal at the time the film was made. Two T-Rex coprolites means not too bad. You know, it's a detail that could have been overlooked, you know. The third one means a little bit stinky. The evidence is non-existent, but the result was actually really cool in the movie, at least to me. The fourth one was really stinky, and it means that the evidence was deliberately ignored. And then the final one, five T-Rex coprolites, means that this was totally fucking horrible and undoubtedly wrong and also completely fucking stupid.
Yeah.
Next slide, please. So we're going to start with Velociraptor, famous scene from Jurassic World. Next slide. The top says featherless Velociraptor. Another variable for me to try to handle is, trying to remember what my slide titles are. So we're going to sort of investigate the featherless Velociraptor. Velociraptor belongs to a group of dinosaurs called the Dromaeosaurids. And Dromaeosaurids were known to be feathered beginning in 1999. This is a slide of a feathered Dromaeosaurid that was found in China. This particular species was described in 2000, this particular specimen in 2003. This animal is called Microraptor, but the first feathered Dromaeosaurid was found in 1999. So about 6 years after the first Jurassic Park movie was released. Next slide, Lauren. This is a slide of an image of the forearm bones, the ulna bones of a Velociraptor versus a bird. And if you look at the velociraptor ulna, the forearm bone of velociraptor, it actually has quill knobs along the back edge of the ulna. So in other words, the bone has little knobs along the back edge that in modern birds, those are where primary feathers attach, flight feathers attach. So this was direct evidence when this was published in 2007. We had already from China, beginning in 1999, evidence of feathered members of the velociraptor family. This bone, when it was published in 2007, showed that velociraptor itself had feathers at least on the forelimb. So that tells us that this animal, those two pieces of evidence together, tell us that this animal, velociraptor, was indeed feathered and probably feathered over quite a large part of its body. Next slide, please. The funny thing is that in the third Jurassic Park movie, if anybody had the misfortune to see that one, I did back in 2001, they actually tried to kind of cover up their mistake in some ways. They, rather than lean in, they sort of tried to backtrack a little bit, and this just makes the whole damn thing worse. So in Jurassic Park 3, they actually show Velociraptor with these little tiny quills on the back of its neck. It's kind of like they're like, oh shit, we were wrong, but... You know, but we can't really do anything about that now, so let's, you know, kind of make our puppet have little tiny feathers. Next slide, please. But the what the top says part one, featherless velociraptor, on the shittiness score in the shittiness scale that you guys have already seen, the featherless velociraptor gets a one coprolite, because in my mind this is a forgivable offense. It's well known now that Velociraptor was feathered, but this is an animal that at the time in 1993, we didn't know for sure if it was. There was a lot of speculation that dromaeosaurids were closely related to birds and that therefore they may have been feathered. But at the time, we didn't know for sure. And so those discoveries came a little bit later. And as a result, in my mind, Velociraptor gets a one. Shit, score. Next slide. The second part of Velociraptor, that slide heading says ginormous Velociraptor, and there's a shot of Chris Pratt, next to his pet Velociraptor Blue from the Jurassic World movies. I realized as I was doing this that I think I have a crush on Chris Pratt. Who doesn't? Because as I was doing this, it just kept being Chris Pratt image over Chris Pratt image. But this particular one I think was really great because it shows just how damn big the people in Jurassic World, made the Velociraptor, to be. Chris Pratt is a pretty big dude, and this, Velociraptor is as tall as he is. This is a sort of a graphic, thank the internet for all the love and hate to Jurassic Park and its movies that have been expressed over the years, because there's a lot of really good imagery about some of these fallacies in Jurassic Park. Here's an example of what the real Velociraptor was like. The real Velociraptor is an animal that would be about probably 2 feet high, maybe a maximum of 6 feet long. The Velociraptor in the movies is actually quite a bit bigger than that. Next slide, please. Thankfully, and I think they made the Velociraptor in the movies bigger because it sounds cooler. It's like cooler to have the kids chased around by, a giant animal that could eat them, whatever. Thankfully, in the case of Jurassic Park, the same year that Jurassic Park was released, the first of what we call giant dromaeosaurids was published. And this particular animal here, the large animal on the top, is an animal called Utah Raptor. This animal may have been 5 meters long. It's about 16 and a half feet long and weighed about 300 kilograms, so about almost 700 pounds. So the size of a good sized bear. The Velociraptor itself, the actual Velociraptor, is shown at lower left and is clearly much smaller. Utah Raptor was discovered in 1993, the same year as the original Jurassic Park. So a very fortunate coincidence that a giant dromaeosaurid, a giant raptor, was published the same year that the movie came out. Next slide, please. So where does the ginormous raptor fall on the shittiness score? Well, I give it four coprolites because in my mind, it's the kind of thing where the evidence was deliberately ignored, but Spielberg got lucky because a giant raptor was found the same year. So the featherless velociraptor I can forgive, but the giant velociraptor was something we knew didn't actually exist, and it was made larger because the movie was needed it to be bigger. All right, the third part here is about the dinosaur Dilophosaurus, and this is a little bit of a little clip that Lauren will play for you now.
Yeah, no idea.
I cut off the worst parts in case anybody doesn't like violence. My wife and I actually, we can't watch anything on TV that has any type of violence to anyone. I figured some of you guys might be sensitive to that sort of thing as well. The Dilophosaurus in Jurassic Park, that's one of my favorite scenes in the whole damn movie. That animal is reconstructed as really, really cool and really interesting. But as you'll see, it's not really that much like the original Dilophosaurus. Next slide, please. Previous slide, please. This is really hard. Dilophosaurus was not, in the movie it's depicted as being able to spit venom at the guy that played Newman and Seinfeld in particular. And it also is displayed with this gigantic neck frill thingy. Next slide, please. But if Dilophosaurus was actually venomous, we would expect to see some evidence of this potentially in its fossils, and the answer is we do not. The Dilophosaurus is known from good skulls, from multiple skulls and teeth, and many venom-bearing animals have grooves in their teeth for that the venom travels down as they deliver the venom, as they bite their prey item or whatever it might be. And Dilophosaurus has no such thing. So there's no evidence whatsoever that Dilophosaurus had venom, whether it spatted or whether it delivered it through fangs or anything like that. So what this was a clever plot device on the part of the producers of Jurassic Park. Next slide, please. Also, Dilophosaurus, oddly, because you'd think that they would want Dilophosaurus to be as big and scary as possible, they actually made it smaller for some fucked up reason. And so on the right here is Dilophosaurus as it actually was. This is an animal that if this animal was in the room right now, we'd be running for our lives. This is a big, probably 6 meter, probably 1,000 pound theropod dinosaur that would, not hesitate to make any one of us its lunch. But in the movie, this is a much smaller creature that's, given these abilities to spit venom and so forth. Next slide, Lauren, thank you. One other kind of subtle detail about Dilophosaurus is, and this is actually true of all the meat-eating dinosaurs in Jurassic Park. In fact, this is something that, you can impress your friends if you, or unimpress them, I guess would be a better way to put it. If you're, at a party or something, or a really lame-ass party. But one major problem with Jurassic Park to a paleontologist, this is something that nobody else would care about, but one major problem with Jurassic Park is that all of the predatory dinosaurs, the theropod dinosaurs, the meat-eating dinosaurs, so theropods include all meat-eating dinosaurs that you've ever heard of in your life, so T-Rex, Velociraptor, Allosaurus, whatever, Carnotaurus, everything. Based on their fossils, the way that their arm bones fit together, they could not put their palms downward. And this is the classic Jurassic Park pose. I can't do this because I have a beer in one hand and a mic in the other, but oh, thank you. Wow, Lauren, I swear to God, Lauren and I didn't practice this, but her presence has been absolutely invaluable for this. So Jurassic Park's predatory dinosaurs completely suck because they couldn't do that. However, they could, and they did, keep their forelimbs with their palms facing inward. Thank you again, Lauren, for doing that better than I could have possibly imagined. The evidence, ironically, the evidence for this comes from an animal that, if not Dilophosaurus, something that was very closely related. Next slide, please. This is, believe it or not, and this is something that you're going to have to take my word for it, because it looks like nothing on a screen this small, but this is a resting trace. We, believe it or not, we have, in addition to bones of dinosaurs, we paleontologists have thousands, if not tens of thousands, of trace fossils of dinosaurs. And trace fossils include things like footprints, things like fossil poop, things like eggs and nests and other indirect or direct evidence that dinosaurs existed without evidence of their bones themselves. What this is a trace of a dinosaur, one of the very few traces of a dinosaur sitting down that we know of. And this animal was lived at the same time and in the same place as Dilophosaurus. It's also about the same size, and the tracks are about what we would expect for the front and hind legs of Dilophosaurus. So there's an excellent chance this was made by Dilophosaurus or something very similar. Next slide, please. This is a reconstruction, kind of an artist's conception of what this sitting down animal looked like. And if you look closely, you can see, and this is based on the tracks, you can see that the animal puts its hands down with its hands to the side rather than having its palms downward. This is one of our pieces of evidence. Thank you, Lauren, again, for this great illustrative image. I feel like Pat Sajak or something. They put their hands down on the sides rather than having their palms downward. And you'd think if a dinosaur could put its palms downward, it would definitely do so while it was sitting down, but this particular animal did not. So this is excellent evidence in conjunction with the actual way the bones fit together that this creature could not put its palms downward. And so again, impress or unimpress your friends by telling them that one thing that's wrong with Jurassic Park, one of the many things that's wrong with Jurassic Park, is that the predatory dinosaurs didn't have their palms downward. So Dilophosaurus as a whole, I would call three coprolites worth. A little stinky, but the evidence is non-existent either way, but the result is pretty damn cool. All right, this is a dinosaur that's close to my heart. This is a scene from Jurassic Park 3. This is where Spinosaurus battles Tyrannosaurus Rex. Mandy, you might want to avert your eyes. Ouch. Let's talk a little bit about the truthfulness of this scenario. So Spinosaurus, I'll say, Spinosaurus is one of the most badass dinosaurs that there ever was. My own specialty is actually studying dinosaurs from the Southern Hemisphere continents, and Spinosaurus is emblematic of the weirdness of dinosaurs from that time and place. That being said, we now know that Spinosaurus, rather than being a giant land-dwelling, dinosaur-killing murder bird like T-Rex, this was an animal that lived in aquatic environments and probably hunted fish. It was a little bit bigger than T-Rex, but it was adapted for aquatic environments and therefore probably wouldn't have fared very well on land, especially against an animal that, like Tyrannosaurus Rex, that was adapted for killing and eating other large dinosaurs. So as much as I would love to say that Spinosaurus would have won this fight, next slide, please. It's extremely unlikely that it would have. Also, and this is something that we just have to kind of go with Jurassic Park movies, because these are clone dinosaurs all from different time periods and things like that. That being said, T-Rex and Spinosaurus literally would have never encountered one another in life. They lived 30 million years apart on different continents that were separated by that time. So again, you know, you can kind of make the exception for the purposes of the movie, but these dinosaurs would have never encountered one another in life. Next slide, please. And so what does Spinosaurus get on the shittiness score? I'm gonna call it forgivable, because at the time when Jurassic Park 3 was made, Spinosaurus was still known from very incomplete fossils, and therefore people weren't really sure what it looked like. In more recent times, though, we found that Spinosaurus was, again, this aquatic animal that was adapted for catching fish in the water, things like that. If it ever found itself on land and was confronted with a giant predatory dinosaur such as T-Rex, I think it probably would have tried to get the hell out of there, and wisely so. Next slide, please. So the fifth point in the Jurassic Park takedown is 66 plus million year old DNA. There's our friend, Mr. DNA. DNA is a super fragile molecule. It doesn't last very long as far as we know. So some molecules actually last quite a long time in the fossil record. DNA is not one of them. Next slide, please. In fact, the oldest known DNA is about 700,000 years old. And that sounds like that's really fucking old, right? But when you think about, next slide please, when you think about the time, you know, geologic time, how old the Earth is, you know, how old dinosaurs are, how old non-avian dinosaurs, in other words, non-bird dinosaurs are, this horse dates to 700,000 years old. Next slide please. The last known non-avian dinosaurs, in other words, non-bird dinosaurs, date to 66 million years old. Next slide, please. So when you do the math, and it's honestly not that hard, even when you've had a bunch of beer, the oldest known DNA is separated from the youngest known non-avian dinosaurs by more than 65 million years, which means that we won't be seeing Jurassic Park anytime soon. It's possible, I will say this, every time science says that something is impossible, were proven wrong, or almost every time. Like, you know, it's easy to say, oh, that'll never happen. But science advances so rapidly and in directions that we could have never imagined oftentimes. And so it would be totally premature and stupid for me to say that something like Jurassic Park could never ever happen. In the meantime, however, there's no evidence that it's going to happen anytime soon. The top slide, the header on the slide says, "Welcome to Pleistocene Park," because, I mean, that's about the best we can do. Come see the horse. I actually joke that maybe sometime, you know, in the future, some distant paleontologist will uncover, you know, remains of modern Western Pennsylvania animals. And, you know, and do it like a Jurassic Park of that. And, you know, come see the white-tailed deer or the raccoon. You know? Not really that exciting. Next slide, please. So what does the 66 million-year-old DNA get on the shit scale? I'm going to go with four coprolites. Because it's stinky. The evidence was ignored. We've known for a long time that DNA degrades really rapidly. That being said, if you don't have DNA, you don't have a movie. So I'll give it a pass. Next slide, please. And then finally, my absolute favorite moment from Jurassic Park.
Don't move. Can't see us, so we don't move.
Okay, so I think you can tell from listening to me talk that I am a fan of the Jurassic Park movie, the original Jurassic Park. It was a big influence on me. It was, I would say, a small part of the reason why I chose to become a dinosaur paleontologist. That being said, this part of the movie completely sucks ass. This is a shot of the T-Rex exhibit at the Carnegie Museum. I hope we already have been through this. Many of you guys have been there. This is maybe my favorite shot of that exhibit, and it's my favorite shot of my favorite scene in the exhibit, actually. This is super awkward. I couldn't figure out an easy way to do this, but you guys can do this test for yourselves the next time you're at the museum. Go and look at our T-Rex exhibit. It's two T-Rexes facing off over the carcass of a plant-eating dinosaur, simulated carcass. And next slide, Lauren. I tried to point out where the eye sockets are. It just ends up looking really stupid on the slide. But at least you can see that's where the eye sockets are. Interestingly, in T-Rex, the eye sockets face mostly forward, which means that this animal had, unlike most other predatory dinosaurs, this animal had binocular vision, at least to a degree, which means that it had depth perception. In other words, it could tell, if you were standing in front of T-Rex, it could tell just how far away you were, which means that it would know exactly when and where to strike, like how far away you were from it. This is something that's extremely uncommon in predatory dinosaurs. We don't see this very much. And this suggests that of all the dinosaurs they could have picked to have shitty vision, they picked one of the worst, the absolute worst. T-Rex probably had much better vision than most other predatory dinosaurs. Next slide, please. Now, there's a conceit in the movie, and you guys, you know, some astute Jurassic Park fans out there might be saying, well, you know, in the movie they say they bred T-Rex with frog DNA, and that's why, you know, because they say something to the effect of the reason the T-Rex can't see is because it's part frog. I'm not an expert in frogs. Thankfully, we have someone who is, but I'm about 99% sure that a frog can still see you if you don't move. Like, having vision where you lose your vision if the thing doesn't move, that sounds like a really great way to go fucking extinct. And so this whole thing was just complete crap, terrible. Next slide. This gets my only 5 coprolite rating, which I would describe as totally fucking horrible, undoubtedly wrong, and also completely stupid.
Yeah.
Next slide. Or...
that is one big pile of shit.
But again, as I, you know, sit here and make fun of Jurassic Park, it's really easy to do. I mean, it's, you know, it's of course, the people that produce this aren't scientists. They're using, you know, scientific knowledge at the time, but naturally scientific knowledge evolves and people get things wrong and so forth. Next slide, please. And so in this sense, I really want to call attention to the fact that these are movies. And in the sense of entertainment, they're perfect. Next slide, please. The first one is, anyway. The rest of the movies are pretty crap. This scene here, I have to show this. I'm probably running over my time, and I apologize if that's the case. But I just have to show this scene because it'll give you a window into, you know, in the spirit of Nerd Night. When I first saw this in the theater in 1993, 17-year-old me's mind was so blown by this scene that I literally didn't remember the rest of the movie. Velociraptor fighting T-Rex, this is like baby Matt's wet dream. Fuck yeah. All right, and we're winding down here. The final part, as I want to say, even some of the other movies have their moments, and in particular, this is a self-serving moment. Next slide. If you have seen Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom, the most recent one that came out, I think, a couple of summers ago, there's this shot of Jeff Goldblum, much older than he was in the first Jurassic Park. Next slide, please. Showing off around the same time, there's like a briefcase of DNA. And if you zoom in on this, one of the vials reads Dreadnoughtus. Now, why the hell does that matter? Next slide. Thank you, Chase, for the help there. That was good. Yeah, I appreciate that. I'll do the same for you. Yeah. So the Dreadnoughtus actually has a special connection to yours truly. You are 1 degree of separation from Dreadnoughtus. This is a much younger me with much shorter hair and much skinnier self. Is sitting with the femur of Dreadnoughtus, the thigh bone of Dreadnoughtus, in 2005 and 2006. We ended up discovering, this is in southern Patagonia, Argentina. You would know that if you could read the top. Next slide, please. And we ended up publishing this dinosaur and giving it its name. So the long story short is, next slide please, Lauren, this giant plant-eating dinosaur from Argentina was named, well, actually technically co-named by me and co-discovered by me. And so in a sense, and I sound like a dick when I'm saying that, sorry. But I want to make sure you guys know I have street cred too, you know. This dinosaur, it's actually really magical for me because as somebody who was influenced by Jurassic Park and somebody who was a massive fan of Jurassic Park and somebody who was, when they were 17, saw that Brachiosaurus appear on the screen and got chills and still gets chills when I see this the thing to this day, it's really cool to know that things have come full circle in a way, and one of my own dinosaurs has a little cameo in the most recent Jurassic Park movie. So it's so awesome that it makes me want to kiss a velociraptor. Thank you guys so much. I'm sorry this was so rough. Next slide, please. Enjoy. And the next two presentations are definitely going to be better, so enjoy.
We got 5 minutes for questions. If you have a question, just come up to the front and we'll take them as they come. And I'll actually ask the first question. Yes, Ms. Wolf. What's that?
So, I've got a question about Dreadnoughtus. Do you know how heavy it was?
Yeah. Can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
Great. So the question was, how heavy was Dreadnoughtus? This is the titanosaur that I mentioned at the end of the talk. The animal was, it depends on what method you do to estimate the mass. So if you go with bone strength factors, so basically measuring the circumference of the upper arm bone and the upper leg bone, you get an answer of about 60 tons, which is really big. If you go with volumetric estimates, you get an estimate that's somewhat lower, so about 40 tons, so about two-thirds that mass. The cool thing about that is either one of these is really, really massive. So the biggest elephant you've ever seen in your life, it's probably about 5 tons. So even the lower estimate would be 8 of that elephant put together into one giant beast.
Well, first of all, thank you for coming out, being a great entertainer as presenter. My question is, when I was in college, my professor about dinosaurs had mentioned about Spinosaurus, that based on the spine, how the spines are, how they are not thin but rather thicker, that he speculated that they were not in fact for a sail but rather a large body mass for being buoyancy in water and large muscles. Do you buy that argument, or do you think that's something that isn't pertinent to the evidence provided?
Yeah, so the question was what the function of the Spinosaurus sail was, or what the function of the tall spines in the back vertebrae was. An excellent question, by the way. The short answer is we don't know. And I think the important thing to remember with Spinosaurus is that there have been 3 partial skeletons discovered in the history of the planet, and 2 were blown up in World War II. So, which really sucks. But it's the kind of thing that more material will lead to a better answer, I think. I think that the current thinking based on the one skeleton that does exist is that it probably was some kind of fin or sail or something like that. In part because to support all that epaxial musculature along a sail that's 6 feet tall, you're talking about an incredible amount of weight. And without like an obvious functional reason to have that, one thing to remember is that when an animal grows something, it's evolutionarily expensive. So there better be a damn good reason for it. And so, like, if you're going to grow a 6 foot tall sail and cover it with muscle and fat or whatever it might be, you better have a great reason to do that. And as far as we know, there is no obvious reason why Spinosaurus would do that. So the best guess right now is that the sail of Spinosaurus was something like a billboard to other species, other members of its species, things like that. But excellent question, and one that the answer to be determined.
Hey there, great presentation for sure. My question pertains to the specific roars of dinosaurs. So yeah. It seems like everyone has its trademark roar. How do we know what they sound like?
That is an absolutely fantastic question. Many things that we think we know about dinosaurs, we infer from their closest living relatives. And that includes crocodiles on one side and birds on the other. And in particular, birds such as what we call ratites, like things like ostriches and emus and rheas and things like that. What's interesting is that both crocs and ratites can't roar. They can't really make much noise and really any kind of distinctive noises at all. In fact, things like ostriches make a sort of a low rumble rather than a squawk or a song or anything like that we normally associate birds with. We don't know of any crocs or birds that could roar. And so the balance of the evidence suggests, and I didn't go into this, but it's excellent that you brought it up, the balance of the evidence suggests that dinosaurs couldn't stand there and bellow ferociously. That being said, it's a little bit limiting, a little bit challenging to infer all dinosaur behavior just from the tiny sample of dinosaur relatives that we have left. Remember that this was a group that was around for 165 million years and that evolved to live on every continent, ranged in size from something I could fit in the palm of my hand to something that could step on me and not even notice. And so the idea that everything is limited by the two, what we call the extant phylogenetic bracket of dinosaurs is a little bit tenuous in its own right. That being said, there's no evidence at the moment that dinosaurs could roar. It's okay, I can repeat the question if you, I can hear you. Oh yeah, so this is an excellent question. So a paleontologist who sadly he was quite an influence on me and quite an excellent guy, a paleontologist named Dale Russell, proposed back in the 80s that if dinosaurs had not gone extinct, or if non-avian dinosaurs had not gone extinct, they might have continued to evolve and potentially evolved into a human-like form that he termed the dinosaurite. I think somewhat speculatively, maybe a little bit tongue-in-cheek, things like that. I think that it's not completely out of the question. That being said, human intelligence has evolved once in the history of life, which means that the chances of it evolving, are not great. It's not impossible what Dale proposed, but I would say it's a little bit unlikely, and I think even he would have admitted that. Sadly, Dale Russell passed away in December, so just a month ago, and the proponent of the dinosaurite, so we can't ask him ourselves. So, but excellent question.
All right, let's get another round of applause for Matt.
Thanks. Thank you guys so much.
All right, we'll take a quick five, grab some more drinks, and we'll get Chase up here in a minute.
Yeah. Do you want to try your finger?
What?
Do you want to try your finger?